Well, I think I'm going to ask a few questions.
Sure.
to start off with. I guess you've sort of said that a lot of the plans that Republicans have offered in Congress are Obamacare light or don't represent full repeal. Can you explain or define the policy distinction between what you would consider Obamacare light and what you would consider a genuine alternative?
Sure, I think a couple of things. One, and this sounds very inside DC when you start talking about baselines, and it sounds very wonkish, and I mean, for the real world, what does that really mean? But I think a lot of these plans have said, well, look, the new world is Obamacare is the law of the land, so if we spend more than before Obamacare but less than him, that's a spending cut. Obamacare is the law of the land, so if we raise taxes but not as much as he did, then that's a tax cut. I think that's nonsense. I think full repeal means we're repealing all of the spending increases and all of the tax increases, period. That's the first point. Now, a lot of candidates for the United States Senate, as well as the House and governors, but mainly the United States House and Senate, last year won elections opposing this president's policies. One of the most popular TV ads in November of 2014 was that we are going to repeal Obamacare. Give us the majority, we will repeal Obamacare. I campaigned for a lot of candidates. I don't remember the fine print saying, we're just going to repeal the easy parts. Or we didn't really mean it, we're just going to repeal part of it. The rhetoric on the campaign trail was, give us the majority and we will repeal it. And you know what? Those candidates won in purple, red, and blue states, which says to me that the people want Obamacare to be repealed. So I think as a baseline, as a starting point, you have to get rid of all the tax increases, you got to get rid of the spending increases, and then you need to start by saying, how do we actually reduce costs? To me, that's actually a full repeal and replace of Obamacare.
But what they'd argue is sort of, look, Obamacare has been the law of the land in 2010. In 2017, when a Republican president, perhaps President Jindal, is in a position to implement an alternative, the baseline would have been in place for 7 years. That's sort of what the assumption is. So they'd say, isn't it kind of bizarre to go back to what the world would have looked like in 2010 had something never happened?
I'd say three things. One, I wouldn't wait till 2017. I think they need to pass the replacement plan today. And I think the court ruling gives them a chance. I think we need to challenge the president to do the right thing. I think we need to challenge Democrats. They'll be up for election to do the right thing. I think we should concede that we can't do this. We shouldn't, as an earlier speaker said, simply negotiate against ourselves. Secondly, if they really meant that, they should have been honest with the voters. Last year, they should have gone to the voters and said, you know what? We don't really mean it when we say repeal Obamacare. We really can't do it. It's been the law of the land long enough. You know, we're just going to modify it. They should have had that election and given the voters an honest choice. And third, I go back to a point I made earlier. If we accept this new level of dependence as the norm, then we're done. Because this president has now grown government dependence and spending and borrowing to unsustainable, unprecedented levels. And I would argue a bigger point, even outside of healthcare, but including in Obamacare, if we take this as the new normal, we won't see the economic growth that we're accustomed to in this country. We won't preserve the American dream for our children and grandchildren. I think it's absolutely critical. If we're going to restore what we want, what we view as freedom in this country, and the American dream, and the opportunities to work hard and get a great job in this country, we can't sustain this level of spending, borrowing, and dependence. So I think it's a fundamental mistake for Republicans to concede, well, look, you know, this is the new baseline. We can't do any better than this. I think it's absolutely realistic to go back before Obamacare was the law of the land. And by the way, that is what they told us they were going to do. They didn't mean it. They should have at least been honest enough to tell us that.
But there are conservatives who would challenge you on that and say that you're actually the one that's surrendering and giving into the idea that Democrats perpetuate that any free market plan isn't going to be able to cover and isn't going to be able to compete on coverage with Democrats. And they'd say that you're actually the one that's giving in to the premise of the left. How would you respond to that?
I'd say two things. Again, I think it's a mistake to measure success by how many cards people have when it's not meaningful access. The reality is once you fall in that debate, Democrats will always be willing to spend more. And if once we fall into that debate, all we do is become cheaper Democrats. We're not standing for something radically different. All we are is saying, well, they're going to get you a single-payer system this quickly. We're just going to get there more slowly. And I think that's the wrong debate to have. I think that once you concede that premise, then, well, of course, if the president's willing to use the force of federal law and the IRS to force you to buy insurance you don't want and is willing to count as coverage cards that don't have meaningful access, including Medicaid, then you fall into this trap where, as we saw with the Oregon study, after a couple of years, yeah, there's no meaningful physical health care improvements after Medicaid expansion, but we're going to count it as a success because you've got a Medicaid card. That's not success. And I think that we need to be willing to stand up and say what he said. By the way, what he said in 08 was pretty popular. He got elected saying things. He didn't talk about giving people cards in 08. He talked about driving down costs and making healthcare more affordable. He said to Hillary, the issue is affordability, and he was right. He was right and she was wrong in 2008. So I think as conservatives, we need to be willing to stand up for liberty and say, yeah, you know what, you're right. If you want to elect a party that's going to use the force of government to force you to buy something you don't want, that's not what we stand for. If instead you want a party that's going to focus on making healthcare affordable, helping people that are truly vulnerable, I do think you need to help people with pre-existing conditions. I do think you need to help people who are priced out of the individual market. I don't think you do it with a massive federal takeover of healthcare. I think there are better, more targeted ways to do it. In our plan, we give to the states $100 billion over 10 years. We talk about the use of high-risk pools, of reinsurance and other mechanisms to help people who truly need that help. But I don't think you need a federal takeover of the healthcare system to help those that truly do need that help. And I think it's fundamentally a mistake to measure dependence as success. And that's exactly what the president would want us to do.
Now, on the Supreme Court case, which you mentioned, just to clear right off the bat, if the Supreme Court struck down the federal exchange subsidies, you would not set up an exchange in Louisiana.
We would not set up an exchange for a couple of reasons. One, let's say the state does give a clear ruling based on the black letter law. If the law is interpreted that way, not only do the subsidies go away, but the mandates, for the most part, go away. So your individual and your employer mandates, for the most part, go away. I've written an op-ed showing that if the court rules the way that I think it should, that's in effect a tax cut for our economy, for businesses and families, tens of billions of dollars. It's spending cuts of hundreds of billions of dollars. But I think to preempt what I think the president will try to do politically and for substantive reasons, that's why I think it's so important that Congress pass, not once it happens, before it happens, or a repeal and replacement plan. But no, we wouldn't set up the state exchange.
Okay, on that, the idea that you outlined, let's take that scenario. So Republicans pass a full comprehensive replacement, and then Obama vetoes it, and then what? You're still left with a situation in which millions of people are losing coverage. Obama has the names of those people. As you said, he could put them out and say, look at these people who are losing their coverage. Republicans have said that they'd feel a lot of pressure to do something. They've talked about creating some sort of bridge that would essentially be a temporary patch that would keep people over at least until 2017, where you could pass comprehensive plan.
But now you're talking about two hypotheticals. You're saying, let's assume the court does something. Let's assume three hypotheticals. Let's assume Congress something, and let's assume the president does something. Let's go back to that second hypothetical. Let's go back to that second to the third hypothetical. Let's say court rules. Let's say Congress passes before the court rules. Now, instead of the president saying, well, look at this person about to lose their coverage, it's Republicans saying, no, that's not right, Mr. President. They can keep that. We've got a plan that actually helps people that needs help if you'll simply sign this bill and not veto it. I think that's a very different discussion and debate. And I don't know that we know exactly what's going to happen in that scenario. I think that's a different scenario than if we pass nothing. And then the president can simply say, here's my one-page bill, or here, even worse, here's HHS pretending these federal-run exchanges or really state-run exchanges or some cosmetic agreements with the individual states. I think that's a very different scenario. And I think that instead of surrender, now look, I know that the temptation in D.C., especially in Congress, is to surrender before the fight starts. You know, we've seen that time and time again. On amnesty, on the executive orders, we're seeing it on the Iran bill, on the negotiations with Iran. I don't think Congress should surrender. You know, here we are, we're talking about something that hasn't even happened, three steps that haven't happened yet. Let's not even talk about surrender, let's go fight. Let's go pass that bill and let's go debate the president and say, we don't want those people to fall between the gaps. That's why we want you to sign our bill in the law. That's why we don't want you to veto it.
So to be clear, you oppose some of the Republican alternatives that would say, let's extend the subsidies for existing people, not allow new enrollees, but people, if they're receiving federal exchange subsidies, would have some sort of way to keep them flowing.
I think the best thing for Congress to do right now is to pass the full repeal and replace plan. And I think instead of negotiating with ourselves, let's pass that, get that to the president's desk, let's have that debate.
So you wouldn't rule it out down the road, you're saying?
What I'm saying is we need to repeal the entire plan and replace it. And let's do that instead. I'm saying absolutely, let's pass the full repeal plan and go have that debate with the president.
Okay. And on your plan, another one of the criticisms is you have a plan that moves toward, and this is something we talked about in the earlier program, that it relies on a standard deduction rather than a tax credit. And what that does is it tells people that they can get a standard amount of money that reduces their tax liability when, you know, up to that point when they purchase health insurance. One of the criticisms of that approach is that not only the idea that it can't create broad access as much, but that it could unravel the employer-based market, essentially, because right now you have these pools where employers have a nice mix of healthy and sick and old and young, whereas if there was a standard deduction, people who could get cheap insurance because they're young would take the deduction, go to get cheap insurance, and then you have employers that are stuck with only the older and sickest and most expensive customers, which drives up their insurance costs. So a lot of employers might say, we're not going to keep having employer-based insurance anymore. And this has been, you know, this is how half of Americans get their insurance. So how would you respond to that?
Sure. Well, I guess there are three different positions one can take. Dozens, but three, let's for the sake of simplicity. On one extreme, those that say, look, we are absolutely wed to the employer-provided healthcare system. As much as it was an accident of history, it is where we are today, we don't want to do anything to change it, so we're going to lock people in. And if you have employer-provided healthcare, you don't get anything outside of that. You're forced to buy that healthcare, whether you like it, whether it meets your needs, whether it's good for you, whether it's cheaper or more expensive than what you can get on your own. If you have employer-provided health care available to you, you're not eligible for deductions, tax credits, government assistance. That's one extreme. And that's, we're going to lock people into employer-provided health care coverage whether they want it or not. The other extreme is, you know, this is an accident of history, so we're going to give everybody money to go shop on their own, and we're going to just take away the exclusion, we're going to take away people's ability to get health care through their employers. We've done neither of those extremes. We've said that if you provide a high enough deduction in the short term based on what people are spending today, if you allow interstate purchase of insurance, you allow voluntary purchasing pools where people can get economies of scale, not just through their employers, but also through faith-based organizations, professional trade associations. They have ERISA-like protections that employers get today, so they get the same protections by joining these groups. And you also say, by the way, if people leave their employers, they don't have to exhaust COBRA before they can go into the individual market. You make those kinds of reforms, then you'll see a voluntary and gradual movement as people go and buy healthcare where they want. I think freedom's a good thing. And you're right, there are some people that say, no, that we want to tell you how you should receive your healthcare. It's either going to be the government's going to tell you, or you have to buy it through your employer, or you have to buy it through this government exchange marketplace. I actually think freedom's a good thing, and I think choice is a good thing. And I trust the American people to decide for themselves rather than being told how they have to get their health care. But we've also done it in a way that we think is gradual and incremental enough that it doesn't cause disruption to the employer-provided marketplace. I do think that's important. That is one of the major sources of stability for privately purchased health care. And these new marketplaces aren't going to be created overnight, so I think it's important that you create a gradual pathway where people have more choices. And I think that'll happen incrementally. I don't think this worst case scenario can happen, because I don't think people overnight are going to have all these different choices. I think over time you will see a more robust marketplace. I think that's a great thing. I think competition is a great thing. At the same time, we're also expanding access to HSAs and MSAs. I know Obamacare curtailed some of the ability of people to buy products that actually meets their healthcare needs. So I think folks in a variety of circumstances will have all kinds of options to pay for their own healthcare, to save against their healthcare expenses, through their employers or on their own. We shouldn't be afraid of competition and choice. We shouldn't be afraid of trusting the American consumers. As conservatives, we either believe in that or we don't.